until I smile at you. What good would it do for tears would fill my eyes, my heart.
That's all for now, enemies, but there'll be more of the same tomorrow night. Until then, this is Orphan M, your number one enemy, reminding me G.I., always to be good. Goodbye now.
General quarters, all in.
I wanted to join the Navy. I figured if I was drafted into the Army or Marines, I'd be a target for everything. But being in the Navy, I'd be on one ship and be less of a target. And I figured my chances of survival with the Navy would be greater than the Marines or the Army.
And tell me about boot camp. What was that like?
Boot camp, I attended boot camp at Camp Perry, Virginia, south of Richmond. We were young. It was exciting. It was in the swamp area, and we had to crawl on our hands and feet, legs, and I was afraid of snakes and whatnot, but it was an experience.
And how old were you?
Probably 18.
Okay. And then where did you go from boot camp?
After we completed boot camp, we had a two-week vacation at home, and then we went back to camp and went to Newport, Rhode Island. Of course, the USS Pittsburgh was a ship with all types of guns, and we went out to the seashore and had gunnery practice most every day.
And what was your job?
I was a gunner on a quad 40-millimeter amidship on the starboard side.
I love the Navy, so I had to get in it.
And when did you join the Navy?
I went in July the 4th, 1944. I was 17 years old.
And so where did you go to boot camp?
Bainbridge, Maryland.
And what was that like?
Well, it was pretty nice. I liked it.
Did they ever teach you how to swim?
No. I'm scared of water. I won't go water no deeper than 4 feet.
And so what did you think when you first saw this big new ship, the USS Pittsburgh?
A very big ship.
Were you happy that it was the Pittsburgh?
Yeah. Well, what happened, when it was launched, I heard it on the radio when they launched it. So when I went to Newport, Rhode Island, they said, what ship you want on? I said, what's available? And they told me different ships. They said the Pittsburgh. I said, I'll take it, because I knew it was a new ship and close to hometown.
And what was your job on the Pittsburgh?
Well, I was a deckhand up on the main deck, and then sometimes I worked down at in the officers' quarters, the hallway there. We had to take care, keep it clean, and the the officer's restroom.
A ship of that size with that many guns, we felt we were ready for action in the South Pacific, and that's where we headed.
And how did you get there?
We proceeded along the east coast of the Panama Canal, entered the Panama Canal, went through the Panama Canal, stopped at Balboa, Mexico for a short visit, and then from there we went to Honolulu, Hawaii. We were there only a short time, then we joined a fleet at Ulithi in the Caroline Islands. That's where we joined the main fleet.
Boy, I've read about Ulithi, the largest collection of ships in human history, right?
That was our reloading and getting ready for the next mission. When we would go to the combat zone, we picked up ammunition, food, had a little bit of R&R, that was rest and recreation. And we went over on the island, played softball, wrote letters, and just relaxed.
And then, so from Ulithi, where did you go?
Well, wherever combat, where the fleet ever, what course they were taking from there on. But I was always apprehensive and tense leaving the Caroline Islands after being supplied, going to the combat zone, because the unexpected, you never know when that might happen. But once in combat, I was as calm as I am right now. I had a job to do and I performed it to my best of my ability.
Tell me about your first experience of combat.
The invasion of Iwo Jima. Unbelievable. I remember it very well. I can close my eyes and it all goes before me like a movie.
And did you, George kind of expressed some nervousness about, you know, heading into combat. Were you aware that you were going to get in it pretty soon?
Yes, I did, but my battle station was down in number 2 turret in the magazine bomb the ship. Anytime there was drill alarm, I was always in the bomb the ship where all that powder was. So I heard the shooting going on, so it didn't bother me one bit. I figured them Japs wanted to get them carriers instead of a cruiser, so and I never scared.
You really weren't, huh?
No, the only time I scared, the captain said, was on the PA system, we was going to have a sea battle. But we never did find a Jap fleet, so I was happy.
What was life like on the Pittsburgh for you?
Well, we had 3 meals a day and took a shower every night and had clean clothes, so I was happy.
Did you have a lot of ice cream?
Yeah.
How about the ice cream?
It was good. Then one night I was sitting up at in the ship service, I was listening to Tokyo Rose. Both my feet went to sleep. They sounded drill alarm, and I had to go quirk halfway through the ship there to try to get to my battle station. I had a rough time.
You didn't get there quickly enough. You bring up Tokyo Rose. Please talk about, I think some of the people listening to this or watching this won't have ever heard of Tokyo Rose. Can you describe who she was and what her show was like and why you would listen?
Well, she's just talking about different chips and different stuff. And I just sat there and listened to her.
She played music. She played good American music, right?
Yeah.
And would she taunt American sailors and Marines and soldiers?
Yeah.
Can you describe the Franklin's bombing? Did you see that happen?
No, I seen it right after it happened. And none of the planes, no ship shot at that plane. It just come in, dropped its bomb. So a plane shot it, American plane shot it down in.
And what was your job during the towing operation? And the rescue operation.
I was back there to help them hook the cable up. I was back there in fantail when they was hooking the cable up to the Franklin.
Oh, so you were the ones who, one of the ones who helped?
I was back there with them.
Huh.
Then we towed it overnight, so I was I was back about on a fantail about all night. We towed it till the next day, and after it got under its own power, we unhooked it. It was on its own. Then it went to an island, Ulithi. That's where we used to get supplies, at Ulithi, a small island. It was there for a while.
And there were lots of kamikazes by that time.
That did not happen during the invasion of Iwo Jima or Okinawa. That happened later in the war when they were desperate for pilots. And during the towing of the USS Franklin, if it would have been at the beginning of the war, we would be two dead ducks in the water, so to speak, because even after the tow line was attached, our towing operation was so slow that we were at the mercy of the enemy. But our Navy superiority air power that covered us from above saved us.
I think most people listening to this or watching this won't have ever heard of the USS Pittsburgh towing the USS Franklin. So can you describe that event and when it occurred and what it was like and what you did?
Well, there was one lone Japanese plane that planted a drop the bomb right in dead center of the USS Franklin. That particular morning, all the pilots were in their planes ready for takeoff. And then the explosion, smoke and fire and everything. And our captain decided to tow the USS Franklin. We had to get a tow line from Pittsburgh to the USS Franklin, which we had a little difficulty doing. In the meantime, the crew picked up 34 survivors who were floating in the water that already abandoned the USS Franklin. So we were picking up survivors, hooking up the tow line. Once that was accomplished, the towing operation proceeded, and it was such a slow process that I thought we'd never accomplish what we had intentions of doing.
And what was your job, your individual job, while all this was going on?
I was manning the gun that I was assigned to. I was never at battle station. I was always at that same gun location.
And did you see people in the water?
Yes. And one of the survivors, days later, died, and we had a burial at sea, very impressive, solemn, and I just often regretted not finding out that sailor's name, because for the way he was buried, I wished I'd have got his name and talked to his parents afterwards, but I never fulfilled that part.
Why do you think the people of Pittsburgh should know about this?
Well, I think number one, we were proud of our record, and we felt that the crew, they should have been recognized, but we've also felt our record through the citizens of the great city of Pittsburgh should know what we accomplished. You know, to this day, they have no idea that probably the ship broke in two pieces and we survived a typhoon and towed the aircraft carrier when, you know, what we accomplished, and I'm proud of what we've done.
And was Okinawa the last combat that the Pittsburgh saw?
Yeah, the typhoon was June the 5th of 45. So then when we lost the battle, we had to go to Guam, get an artificial battle to come back to the States. We got back States 16th of July, Remington, Washington. We got backstage 16th of July, 45.
I want you to describe what being on a ship in a typhoon is like.
Well, people ask me if I was scared. I told them no, I was too seasick to be scared.
So you were sick, huh?
Yeah, waves 100 and some feet high.
The fleet received words, from what I recall, Admiral Nimitz was in charge of the Navy. He was the admiral. We were heading in the direction of the typhoon, and he issued the order if we increased our speed that we'd bypass the typhoon. This was complied with, but to our dismay, we ran right into the heart of it. And I'll tell you why I'm here talking to you, only the dear Lord knows. And then at 6:30 the next morning, 108 foot of our ship broke off, and we were now two pieces.
Describe what it's like to be on that ship in a typhoon.
Well, there's big valleys, waves 20 feet high that would come down on the crashing on the main deck. The ship would shake and crack and go on. And I had visions of being buried there. But the captain, he used his better judgment. Instead of going forward, putting pressure on the bulkhead that broke off, it was just about a half inch thick, the armor. He put it in reverse to reverse the pressure off the bulkhead while temporary repairs were made. And once they were completed, we proceeded to Guam, Apra Harbor, where we went into dry dock, and they put a temporary bow, and then we proceeded to the state of Washington for major repairs.
You said something to me before we sat down, something about you'd rather be in combat. Can you say that again?
I'd rather spend a week in combat as 2 hours in a typhoon.
That's how bad it is.
There was nothing you could do. You were at the mercy of the sea. We sat there at the bottom of the ladder and thoughts, you know, my thought was, I'm never going to make it out of this situation.
And then, I mean, was it so loud that you could never have heard the bow breaking off? Because everything's...
What happened on that particular occasion, you could hear a louder crackling going on. And when the bow broke loose, there we were. And the sea was still taking a pounding from the sea.
Were there any casualties on board?
We had never lost a man through the bow being, because that's where we had all our supplies, up on the bow. From the turret back, number one turret, to the aft part of the ship, that was living quarters. We didn't lose a man.
And so then, under your own power, you were able to make it back to where?
We proceeded to Guam and went in dry dock and had temporary repairs, and then proceeded to Bremerton, Washington for major repairs.
So you went to every single ship reunion?
Yeah, 37 of them.
Wow-wee.
Last September, a year ago, down in D.C., there was only 3 guys from World War II showed up. And the president, he said, this is it, no more reunions. So now they quit having them.
And how long did the USS Pittsburgh stay in action? When was it decommissioned?
Well, I don't know, but they scrapped it out in Vancouver, I mean, Tacoma, Washington, back in the 70s, I think.
No, I just hope that justice will be done as far as our efforts throughout all these years, not only for the crew, but for the city of Pittsburgh. I think it would be a great thing for us to get recognized and let the city know that we've done something beyond the regular call of duty. And that's all we're asking for.
Within my heart, I know I will never stop to smile again.
Yeah.